You can't afford to be without your vehicle. Bobby and his team of professionals at A1 Quick Oil will get you back on the road fast and with the job done right. All technicians are 100% certified. Behind Napa off Highway 51 North, give Bobby a call.
Here at A1, we don't work on cars, we fix them.
And so this is the 125th anniversary of our school system. Did y'all know that? This year, in October, there was some people gathered up at the courthouse in a meet 125 years ago this October, and they established the Tanishma Parish school system. So we'll be doing a lot of activities this fall to celebrate this very special anniversary. And it just so happens that in our anniversary year, we have rebranded, we have a new logo, and we have a new website for our community and our families. And so if you have not taken a look at our new rebranding and our website, I hope that you'll go to tangyschools.org. And in fact, if I see you on your phones, I'll assume that's what you're looking at. But if you look at that, it's very smartphone friendly, because you know, we realize that a lot of families are just using for smartphones to look up and do a lot of business. So we're very happy about that. And the website is really designed to be very easy for families to find information, or for us, for individuals to apply for jobs, so that we can, you know, recruit the very best here in our parish. We also have developed a family toolkit. So for anyone out there that you may hear people say, I need to get the supply list, or, you know, when am I going to be able to meet my teacher, my son's teacher? We have a toolbox on our website that's in red, actually. It'll catch your attention. And that toolbox has basically everything that a family needs to know to start school and have a really strong start to the school year. So please share that with information with you know, your circle of friends, because I think it's really helpful for our families to have, instead of looking all over the website for different things, they just go one click, everything they need to know there, from bell times to bus information, the bus app that we have that they can download, and they can actually, it's kind of like Uber, it's really cool. They can actually see the bus going along the street, like on the app, and know how close it is to their home, and if it's past their home or not. And so all of that is new technology that we're using, and to make, you know, really to help families to be able to better communicate in terms of for their children. So I encourage you to, if you have not taken a look at our website, please do, because we're super proud of it. And after all, it's only been 125 years. So it's kind of about time, right? Yeah. We want every student, every single student, not some students, not most students, but every student to graduate high school. Every parent wants that. Every child wants that. Every grandparent wants that for their grandchildren. That is a common goal among all stakeholders. We want them to graduate, and not only do we want them to graduate, but we want them to be prepared for life. Because they're thinking about senior trip, right? What are the parents thinking about? You know, where are they going to go to work? Where are they going to go to college? Those types of things. So we want them to be prepared for life after high school. When students enter high school in 9th and 10th grade, they all take basically the same courses. It's called the core. You know how when we went to college, you know, you take the first couple years or so, you take all the core subjects. You take your maths and your Englishes and your other social studies and stuff like that. Well, they all take about the same. Then in their 10th grade year, the students decide, along with their parents, okay, am I planning to go to college, and or do I want to go into the workforce when I graduate? So students decide what they want to do, and that sort of dictates what their 11th and 12th grade year looks like. Can anybody guess how many students at the end of 10th grade say, I'm going to college? Yes.
90%.
You're it's a high number. It's not quite 90, but it's around 60-70% or better, depending on the high school. We'll say it doesn't matter what the grades look like, what it looked like on their ACT, anything. It's like, yeah, we're going to college. So they begin to take courses for college. Do you know how many students actually attend college?
30.
Probably about 30, high 30s, around 37, 38. And better than that, do you know how many students actually complete one whole year of college?
25.
Less than 25. That's right. So the problem is that we have most of our students, because we fluctuate between 76 to the 82% of our students graduating. Yes, I said that out loud.
Wow.
Which means we have about, 20 to 18% that are not. Period. Then we have a high number saying they're going to college and they never go. So they graduated, they have a diploma, and they have no job skills. What am I going to do? But after the senior trip's over, and then they're here, and they're like, okay, well, what's next? So in our plan, what you will see are six priorities to ensure that every student, we're on a mission here, by 2025, it's called Vision 2025, every student graduates high school, not some, not most, all. And not only do they graduate, but we're going to require in Tangipahoa Parish that they have a job credential before they graduate. And even if they say they're going to college, we're going to say, no, 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 that's fine. That's great. You want to go to college? Wonderful. But you're going to have a national, advanced, or basic credential when you graduate from our high school. So, one, they could work while they go through college. Okay, they could have a part-time job. Or if they're in that percentage of that never make it past the first year, they have something to fall back on. Okay? So really our plan is built to do and accomplish that. I think that's a pretty good goal. Don't you? I mean, think about the quality of citizens that we would have if every student graduated and they could secure a high-wage, high-demand job right out of high school. They would be certified welders. They would be CNAs. They could do EMT. They could go to work with Acadian right out of high school. Even if they decided to go to college, they could do that, and they could earn a living. But kids, or our kid, I call them kids, they're not thinking about that when they're in 10th grade, and they're making this decision, and they go home and just tell mom and dad to sign the paper and so they can take their classes next year. It's a big decision. So we are going to require here in Tangipahoa Parish that you have a credential. Now, how are we going to do that? We started this summer by having summer credentialing for students where they come and they work. We paid them minimum wage to come to school this summer and earn a national credential. We have high schools that are going to offer night credentialing starting this fall. And we're also doing after-school programs where kids can get. So if I'm on the college track and I'm taking advanced math and all those things during the day, there's no time in the day for me to do welding, right? But I can stay after school, I can go at night, and I can get my welding degree. We don't care if you take it during the day, after school, in the summer, or at night. But before you graduate from our high school, you're going to have a credential, and you're going to be job ready. And we have an individual that works with our business area, our business and industry in Tangipahoa Parish to say, what are the needs of your business? What are the needs of your, if it's a production company or whatever? We want to build those pathways to match the needs of the businesses that are right here in Tangipahoa Parish. So that's the major goal. And there are six priorities that we have to work towards to get there. We have to have diverse, high-quality staff, right? You've got to have individuals to teach the electrical certification. You've got to have individuals that can teach kids how they can be EMTs. So all of that's part of the plan. You have to have high-quality curriculum, which we throw that word around all the time. And this is what it basically means. And I know all of us know an individual that has gone through high school. They were on a roll. They were in the beta club, and they can't make pass an 18 on ACT. Yep. Have you ever heard of individuals like that? Yeah, they're good kids. They're great kids. They come from, probably some of our own children. That should never happen. So a high-quality curriculum is rigorous. so that when kids get through high school, they will be able to make the score. Do you know what score you have to have in order to get scholarships for college? Anybody want to take a guess?
23.
20. You have to have at least a 20 for a four-year college. The higher your ACT, the more money you get. So naturally, if you have only a 20, the parents are going to be paying quite a bit out of pocket, or they'll do student loans. So we want kids to have the highest ACT. We're going to have after-school programs that will focus on getting their ACT scores up and getting them with a job credential starting this fall in our high schools. So all of that is part of the ultimate goal that we're trying. Now, for a two-year technical college like North Shore Technical, a 17 on the ACT can get them into North Shore for 2 year. But the two-year degrees are that they get at North Shore can be an extension of the credential that they get while they're in high school. So that's our ultimate goal. The other very important piece of our strategic plan is about student well-being. You know, not only student well-being, but employee well-being. You know, we've been through some tough times with the pandemic, and it doesn't look like things are getting much better now. In fact, it seems like the closer we get to school starting, it's starting to pick, you know, things are picking up in terms of cases. So we want to focus on well-being of our students, what they need to be successful, you know, feeling like they're a part of the school family, a sense of belonging, that they have positive relationships, and all of those things are also a part of our strategic plan. But I do encourage you to go to our website and really take a look. If you look at the plan, we have six priorities, we have deliverables, we have action steps for each deliverable, we have people identified and timelines on when those things are going to be done. We have performance targets. So what do you think one of the performance targets it would be if our goal is for kids graduating? Performance target number one is, what is the percent of students graduating in 4 years? And we progress monitor that, and we keep up with that to see how we're doing in that area. Another performance target: how many kids are graduating with a credential when they leave high school? Is it 40%, 50%? What do we want it to be? 100%. So kids can get jobs right out of high school with their national credential. And one of the important things of this curriculum being beefed up and more rigorous is that even for the national credentials, kids have to pass a test. They have to take a national credentialing test. So they have to be better than just basic reading. They have to be in the advanced or mastery level. So it's very important, not only for college-bound students, but for all students. And so I'm super excited about our second strategic plan. I'm mostly excited about it because we started with the people. We started by asking our students. Do you know how many students that we had participate in the electronic survey? Somebody take a guess.
All.
Actually, it was close to 40%, which the partner that we're using to help, you know, this guided us along the strategic planning process, which is school leadership out of New Orleans, said they've never had almost 40% of the parents or the students participate in an actual survey about how to improve the district. I thought it was low, but they said it was extremely high. And of course, our employees, our teachers. Then after all of that, we sat around the table with them just like this and said, now tell us what's wrong with our system. Do you know what parents came back and said? What do you think parents said about how do we improve our system? Anybody want to take a guess?
Communication,
that was one thing. And that's one of our priorities, is better communicating all of the opportunities that kids have. You know what? We can't depend on a 15-year-old making a decision about their life. We need to have the parents at the table, because the 15-year-old is not worried about life after high school. They're just worried about graduating and the senior trip. That's all they have on their mind. And so communication is key. The other thing was parents want help for their kids. They want intervention help. My child's not reading on grade level. How can we help them? How can I get the help they need? Now we have intervention time within the school day. We're going to offer after school programs for all of our elementary and junior highs. We're going to offer STEM for after school for our students that are even our AB students who don't necessarily need interventions for reading and math, but they're interested in STEM and robotics. So those are just some of the things that's exciting. I'm super excited. Not only do I feel like that just the logo was rebranded and the website, but I feel like we're rebranded, and I think we're refocused, and we're more real on what the main thing is. You know, there's an old saying that says, keep the main thing the main thing. I think we get, you know, distracted, and we get bombarded with a whole bunch of stuff. And the main thing is kids need a diploma, and they need to be prepared for life and be able to support themselves and their families. So please go to our website and look at the strategic plan. We'll be doing public update meetings through our board on our progress, on our target, on our measurements, on our target measures that I mentioned. We have about, I think it's 7 total that we have that we'll be reporting out on. So I want to talk a little bit about, I'm going to sort of pivot and talk about what's August look like. So right now, we're not requiring masks or face coverings in our school buildings or in our classrooms. It is recommended by the Department of Health and Hospitals if you haven't been vaccinated and by CDC. But until the governor does an executive order that requires face masks or face coverings in our buildings, we're not going to require it. However, everyone is welcome to wear it if they so choose. That's where we stand. That could change tomorrow if the governor comes out and issues an executive order. And in that case, there's no choice for the public. You know, we have to do that. It is a requirement. If nothing changes between now and August, President Biden issued an executive order a little while ago, maybe a month ago, on public transportation, that you have to wear face covering on public transportation. So anyone that rides our buses to school has to wear the mask while they're on the bus, and then they can take it off once they get on the school campus. They don't have to wear it. So that's where we are. On our website, we have in our toolkit, we have back to school, very explicit information about back to school, all that we're doing to protect the safety of our students and our employees, as well as how are we going to address the social emotional well-being of our students and our employees, and how are we going to provide interventions for kids who are not where they need to be in terms of being advanced or mastery in their reading and in their math and basic skills. A few weeks ago, our registration numbers, they were telling me we had about 550 new students to the school system that were not currently in our school system. And so, you know, as we know, we have areas of the parish, mainly in the Hammond, Ponchatoula area, some of LaRonja, that's continuing to grow. So we have kicked off, it's about $27 million worth of new buildings in our schools that have the highest enrollment growth that's occurring. And so we have new buildings that are going up in Ponchatoula, and in Hammond High has a new building, a two-story wing that's being added to their high school. And so we're doing that now. And so we did that not by additional tax money, but by basically borrowing money to do those $27 million worth of projects. We also, as you know, were successful for the half-penny sales tax for competitive salaries. And that is so that we can bring the very best and have them working with our children. And so now we have a wait list of people to come into our parish to teach, which is very exciting. We can be a little bit more selective about who we have working with our children. And so that's always a great place, you know, a great position to be in as well. And our approach moving forward in terms of, you know, new buildings and growth and how are we going to pay for that is, you know, as you know, our sales tax collections are up in the parish. They have been up. They've been trending up since last year. So what we're doing is we are taking the excess sales tax that we are collecting and we're putting it into a capital outlay account for buildings, sort of like pay as you go. So we're, it's like a savings. We're saving that money so that we can take it and then build additional buildings in addition to the $27 million that we're doing now. So at the very last resort would be to ever have to come back and ask the public for any kind of tax. We want to take what we have, excess in sales tax, put that into the savings account for capital outlay. And this is what I think is the key here. I think that the more we shop at home here in Tangipahoa Parish, or even if you order something where, you know, you're getting the sales tax sent back to our parish, then those revenues will continue to be up. And we will have that excess money that we put into capital outlay so that we can build, continue to build additional buildings that we need throughout the parish and just improve the ones we have. So that's sort of our approach, and that's what we're doing now to address the growth and the improvements to our facilities that we have.
Those 500 kids come with a certain amount of federal money too, don't they?
Well, yeah. So every time that we have an additional student, we get additional MFP money from the state. So that's we always look at those numbers because that helps us in terms of our budget. And that, again, I mean, it does take a certain amount to educate those to every child, but that's money that we're getting to pay for buildings and teachers and things like that. So every new child that we get additional MFP money. It depends on, like, if it's a child with special needs or whatever, but it ranges. But it's somewhere to the effect of, like, $6,000 or $7,000 per child. When I started, I mean, in 2018, well, we received results in 2019. We were a C school district, overall C school district. And we're like 6 or 7 points from being a B district. St. Tammany and Livingston both had dropped in their overall letter, so they're B districts now. And then we didn't have test results last year because of the pandemic. And I don't think we'll have our kids tested this year, but I don't think they're going to produce those labels this year because of just the amount of kids that were quarantined and we had teachers that were quarantined. So I think they're sort of feeling like it's really not fair to assess with letter grades when it wasn't really a normal year. So the most current letter grade that we have is from 2019, and at that time we were a C district. We were actually very disappointed last year when we did not take the state test because we knew that through our strategic plan and the support of our board and the budgeting that we were going to be on track to get higher in our performance score. But because of the pandemic, we didn't test. So that's a very good question. So we're very competitive, I think, with our neighboring districts. And I think our next time that we assess, we're going to be right up there with St. Tammany and Livingston. So the questions about, you know, kids that actually go to college that finish even 1 year or even finish their degree period. I think it's that, you know, probably multiple reasons. I think one, you know, they want to get the quick, earn the money, and if they can get a job in a plant or someplace where they can make money, I think kids, you know, they want a car, they want all those things now, those instant things. I think that may be part of it. I think that there's some kids that start that are not prepared for college, and that goes back to one of our priorities about the curriculum. They think they're ready. They may make the score to get into college on their ACT, but it's just difficult, and it requires a lot of time for studying and things like that, and they're not willing to make that commitment. So I think there's various reasons for that, but I know that the trend and the numbers are consistent, that the amount of kids that actually start college and that actually finish college is almost half a drop. And I think those reasons are multiple.
Let me just say this. We're going to echo everything you say as far as commending Melissa.
We did her evaluation last night, and she's going to be around for a little bit longer. Just let me tell you that. Her evaluation was very, very well. All of our board feels the same way about her. She lets us know exactly what's going to happen, when it's going to happen, and she has that strategic plan to a T, and she knows exactly where she wants to be. And she's so easy to work with, and our board sees that, so we want our community to know that our children are going to advance because of having the superintendent that we have and the people that she has up at central office. So y'all don't have to worry, she's not going anywhere anytime soon.
Well, I appreciate that. It's definitely a team effort. We always talk about this. You know, when you're in a boat and you're rowing toward a vision, a goal, like think of this beautiful island, you know, but you're rowing toward that. You can't have people rowing that way. And you can't have people just sitting in a boat watching you row, right? Everyone has to be rowing in that direction. And I feel like we've got the team that's doing that. And we're all very laser focused. And, you know, people like to get caught up in the everyday stuff. But you have to always be able to bring them back to what is the main thing that we're supposed to be doing here. And that is, you know, everyone wants the diploma. And everyone wants to be able to make a living and be successful in life, raise their family, and live happily ever after right here in Tangipahoa Parish. Two or three schools that we've had at elementary schools in the past that had 21st century. It's a federally funded after-school program, and Amy Elementary is one of those. This year, we're expanding it to all of our elementary schools, not 21st century, but we're doing an after-school program. We had a summer camp this year for the first time ever. We had 2,300 students attend our summer camp programs. They were doing STEM, they were doing the core. We did pre-tests and post-tests so that we could monitor the growth. And so any good after-school program, the 21st century and the ones that we'll do this fall, we have a pre and a post-test so we can measure, is it working? Like, are the kids getting better in the reading and writing and arithmetic? The STEM is one of the things, and robotics is one of the things that's high interest, and it's also, when they get to high school, it's a huge credentialing pathway for students, and we have to start whetting their appetite when they're in elementary school about that potential pathway for the future. So to answer your question, yes, we do pre and post, and yes, we do see improvement in there overall. And let's face it, some of our children are going home. The parents aren't home yet. They're working. We give them a nice healthy snack after school. We provide the transportation home. You know, there's lots of pluses besides just that pre and post test that we give for their overall well-being.
It's time to celebrate. I'm the 2021 Young Women of Excellence Award recipient, Anne-Marie LaCour, and I'm inviting you to the Tangipahoa Parish Summer Reading Program's Awards Day parties. Head on over to your local branch for a party full of games, prizes, refreshments, and you'll even receive a free book. Go to tangilibrary.com for more information. I'll see you this summer in the library.